Thanks for the introduction. I'm Aditya. Yeah, people have a hard time pronouncing my name, but yeah. This work is Reparo, a publicly verifiable repair layer for blockchains. So it's a work with Sri Arvind Krishnan, Bernardo, Daniel, and Aniket. And let's dive in. So I'm just hoping everything works. Okay, so any problem needs some motivation, right? So why are we doing what we're doing? So here are some screenshots of actual problems. This is the parity bug. So this was the issue. So they did not check who the owner of the contract was. So anybody can call the constructor and become the owner. And so he just called it and then killed the contract. So. And then so many people, this was a shared library for a multisig wallet. So all the money got locked in. And this is how Ethereum is actually handling the DAO hard fork. So it's if it's a DAO contract, do something else. Basically, it's a band-aid on how to fix DAO. And this is the multisig hack. This is a bug where they put wrong addresses. This is interesting. So this in this bug, so JavaScript, this utility treated all addresses by default as hex addresses. So if you did not specify 0x, it was by default a hex address. But what if your address didn't have any hex? What if it was just 11100? And now you have to specify that it's hex, otherwise your address will be different. So because of this bug, somebody had sent the money to a wrong address, and that caused some new problems. There's just so many bugs and issues. There's just smart contract errors on the user side when how they used it, or the bad coding. So here are a few more. Okay, so in our survey, we found that there's almost about 4.3 million ethers that stuck this way because of the incorrect code, and it's worth around 11.2 billion. So this number keeps changing as I check Coinbase or something. So this is as of half an hour ago. So we know the problem, right? We know that contracts are hard to verify that they're doing the right things, and we want to be able to repair contracts, right? And we're going to take a look at how to do that. So let's take a look at what the related works do. As a summary, we have an immutable blockchain, and we want a repairable blockchain. So now, how do we go from the top to the bottom? Right? How do we transform an immutable blockchain into a repairable one? One technique is using cryptography. So maybe use techniques like attribute-based encryption, chameleon hash functions, and use them to transform an immutable blockchain into a repairable blockchain. Alternatively, you can use consensus, where you say that I will use the layer one. My blockchain itself is aware, and I'm going to use that. So the security argument for consensus-related such protocols is that repairs can be applied by malicious actors only if the same actors can also break consensus. So basically, if malicious repairs are possible, then much worse things can happen because your consensus itself breaks. So you may want to. So that's the argument typically in consensus, and of course you can have both combinations of. So in this work, we take a look at the following factors, right? So first factor is the stateful repair. So we ask if we can repair transactions that result in a different final state. So I may go back to block one and change the genesis itself, and that will result in a cascading changes. And do we support this? So some of them are like, oh no, we can only edit metadata, so that doesn't affect the state. So we are looking for solutions that can allow stateful repairs. System scale MPC, so do all the nodes in the blockchain need to run some protocol together? This would mean that we need to have some mechanism to contact the miners or in a permissionless system and get them to run a protocol. And we look at repairability of existing contents. By this, what I mean is once I say, okay, Ethereum is from today repairable, can I go back and change all the things that were done before today? So in this example, if the first green block is where you actually use the solution, any solution X, can you go and change things before applying that solution? So before block 5000 in this example. And finally, public verifiability or auditability. So can any node in the system see what was repaired and who supported the repairs? So we take a look at this Atnisi et al's solution. It uses a combination of cryptography and consensus. It uses chameleon hash functions concretely, and they allow redacting illicit contents. Maybe let's take a quick recap of what chameleon hash functions are. So a chameleon hash function is like a hash function, but it has a trapdoor tau. Think of it like a secret key in a public key algorithm. And it also has a hashing key. This is like the public key. Using this public key, you can generate a hash. Everybody can generate a hash function. And only the owner of the tau, the trapdoor tau, or you can think of it as a secret key, can find collisions in the hash function. So the owner of the secret key has a special power. So using that, you can clearly see that I can change hash pointers now, right? And the whole point of a blockchain was chained by hashes, and you now have the power to change the hashes. So in this solution, you need an MPC protocol so that not just one miner can change on its own, but you need a bunch of people, a majority of them to change it. And it also supports only stateless repairs. It also requires block modifications. So that means only the blocks that use chameleon hash functions can actually change such hash pointers, right? And you can't change anything that's before that, and it doesn't have public verifiability. So the next solution we take a look at is from Puddu et al. This one introduces new transaction types, mutable and meta transaction. So it's more fine-grained in that sense, but it still relies on the assumption that the miners, for some reason, do not distribute the decryption keys to the redacted data. So it kind of like assumes that I trust them to not do this, and you can't repair a transaction if the origin does not cooperate. So who's the origin? If I send a transaction, if I was the parity bug contract developer and I deployed it using my address, tomorrow, if I can just disappear and no one will be able to repair that transaction, even if it turns out that everybody is using it. The next solution is from Darler et al. So this one uses attribute-based encryption and chameleon hash functions. And you have a policy and you can change the transaction if it follows this policy, and it doesn't require any MPC. So it's more like a layer 2 side. And it lacks public verifiability, and again, it doesn't support REC. The next work is from Buber et al. This is interesting because it uses consensus and no cryptography. And what they do is they take two blocks and connect them by two hash links. And you use on-chain voting for redaction. So if a miner supports that repair, they just say in their extra field, they say, okay, I support this. And if there's sufficient support, you just apply the repair. So if you can see that clearly they don't require any MPC, but their solution requires changes to the block headers, right? To use two hash pointers. This means that now you can't have REC, right? Only blocks that had these two pointers and were mined can be changed in this way. And it's only applicable to stateless repairs. Okay, and finally, the next closest related work is Tezos. And it's again a consensus-based solution, and it's a similar idea to the previous one. And it uses this on-chain governance. So bakers will actually support changes, or they say no, I don't like this change. And if enough support is measured using in multiple rounds, they'll actually apply that change. It doesn't require any MPC, and it's publicly verifiable in the sense that you can see which bakers voted for which change and how we reach the state that we have today. It's a new blockchain protocol, so it can't be applied to existing blockchain. So this is the state of the art. And finally, here's what we propose, right? So we propose Reparo, which allows stateful repairs, doesn't require a system scale MPC, We allow repairability of existing contents and it's publicly verified. Okay, so overview of what Reparo does. So you take a blockchain and make it a repairable blockchain. So this is what Reparo will do. And we allow repair of transactions since Genesis. We allow stateful changes, unlimited repairs. So there's no restriction that you can only repair a block once or so there's no such restrictions. And the repairs are publicly verifiable. Everybody can see who repaired and who proposed it. At least pseudonymously, you know which address proposed it and so on. So you can see that. Okay, and first question that comes to your mind is why Reparo, why not hard forks, right? So hard forks are arbitrary. I would not go into the politics, but so we don't have a reason, right? We did a hard fork because of XXX. We need miner support to actually make sure that all the mining power or more than 50% mining, more than 67% mining power is on one side. So you need the miners to support this. For miners to support something, they need to update their hardware, right? The rig that the customized circuits that they have for this protocol, that needs to be updated. So it would not be in their best interest to keep constantly changing the circuit, right? So you don't want to apply band-aid software fixes too often. And it also adds legacy code, right? So every fork has a if condition, right? If chain length greater than X, use this rule. So you can find this in the Go Ethereum codebase. And every fork is going to keep on increasing this if else. So it's going to keep bloating the code base. So you can see an example of this bloating, right? So if chain config is of such point, you can see that all of these are the different blocks at which different rules will be applied. So another alternative solution that people may ask is, why don't you just locally prune it and just get solve everything, right? So when locally pruning, of course, I know that this block has some links to some illicit content, so I will delete it locally so that I am not liable to prosecution, right? But the blockchain itself is unaware of the repairs, and the protocol may still provide illicit content to other nodes. So a new node joining the system will still get it. So you have not solved that much problem. And if everyone prunes to be compliant, to say a blockchain is running only in Europe and to be GDPR compliant, everybody prunes a block. Now no new node can validate the chain because there's no the link is broken, right? So you can't verify if this chain is really long enough. So okay, this is the problem with the local pruning. Okay, so let's talk about Reparo now. Reparo changes the chain and block validation. So you take an existing blockchain. We are going to use its sub protocols for chain validation, block validation. But what we are going to do is how in C++ we extend a class, we actually inherit all the methods, we change slightly and use the parent classes in functions. So we also preserve the old data so that we can aid validation, and any user can request a repair, and this is just a new transaction that we add. And they can leverage the blockchain's consensus to decide whether or not to apply the repair. And once approved, Reparo just breaks the links in the chain securely to prevent long chain or stale state attacks. So it's very important to break the chain correctly. Otherwise, if you break the hash chain, then it's easily possible for a miner to build an alternate chain with even if it doesn't have 67% hash power. So you need to be careful in breaking the chain. And after applying the repair, Reparo ensures that the unrepaired version is invalid. It's rejected by the new client. So if you provide an unrepaired chain, they will not accept it. So that's why we have to ensure that the repair is done in the consensus layer. So let me, in this talk, I'll talk about Ethereum and Ethereum specific example as to how to enable repairing in Ethereum. So you have a bunch of transactions, and this is the header and this is the body part. So I'll specify the header as we go along. So okay, one field in the header is actually transaction root. So this is the Merkle root of all the transactions in the body. So next, okay, so each block it connects its body to its header using this transaction route. Now, each block, between two blocks, there is a link called as a hash pointer. So this is essentially directly a block at height 3 will include the hash of the block at height 2. And so they are inherently connected. So changing 2, it means we'll have to change 3. So this is the one link. Okay, next, to talk about the second kind of link that's there in Ethereum, I'll just briefly talk about an account. So an account is an object that holds the state in Ethereum. It has a nonce, it has a balance, it has some storage, right? If it's a contract, it will be having a bunch of variables and maps and all sorts of code, all sorts of stuff. So this root is that storage. And the hash of the code is here. So that means if I change a contract, you can see that the root will change, right? And the nonce will change at every transaction. When you call a function in the contract, the nonce will update, increase by 1, and the root will change if you change some local state. So these two things will be changing. And there is another field in the header called the state root. And what the state root does is actually take every contract, every account, which includes your normal accounts with just hold money and not smart contracts, and also the smart contracts. You hash that field that I just showed you, that structure, which just contains 4 elements. You hash them and build the Merkle tree. So this is your state root as of this block. And how to compute the state root for the next block is to take the state at the parent block, apply the transactions in the current block, and then rebuild the state root. And that is your new state root. Okay. So you can see that this is implicitly linking the block, the child block, to the parent block with the hidden implicit pointer called generic pointer, or we call it can be called as state pointer. And this pointer is also it also connects, right? So if you just change the parent hash, no, it doesn't work. You will also have to change if the transaction changes, you'll change the parent hash, you'll have to update both the pointers, basically. Okay, so now let's take a look at how Reparo actually works. So the clients will submit a request to the blockchain. The client on the right is actually sending a repair request, which is in green, and the others are just normal transactions. They could be anything, Uniswap contracts or anything. The miners decide that they'll mine these repair requests just like any other transactions, right? So the miner on top will actually upload it. So currently, in this round, miner 2 won the game, and it produced a block. Again, miner 2 won. And finally, the third block contains the repair transaction. So now we'll see, once a repair request is mined, the miners actually have to decide whether the repair is worth it. So we can see that in this case, it could be a popular bug, it could be a bug in Uniswap, that it could be a DAO bug, it could be parity bug, or it could be a frivolous bug, right? Like that it's not that important, and the miners may decide, okay, this is not worth it. But all the miners need to do is to decide, maybe set a flag in their CLI. And in this case, just to illustrate, the two miners actually agree that this is a serious enough bug that we need to we need to apply this repair. And then what happens is, let's stop and take a look at the repair policy that I just briefly skipped over. So we define a repair policy as P, and it dictates which repairs are valid. For example, in Bitcoin, you may want only stateless repairs, or only you want to prove that there was a bug and that's why I'm doing this repair. So you can dictate that you will only support bug fix, and that will be what P will be dictating. It also dictates who should approve the repairs, right? In a permissionless system, you can have a rule that 90% miners. In Ethereum, you can say if Vitalik supports it and 60% miners support it, then only I will approve the repair. Or we can have another rule that if Satoshi says, like Simon says, the game, if Satoshi says something, we can just do it. So all sorts of rules are possible, and it's dictated by the policy as to who should approve the repairs, and also how to apply the repairs. why we allow the repair policy to tell how to apply the repairs is because if you go too deep, you may be stalling progress, and in that sense you may want to slow things down. As an optimization, the repair policy can dictate how to optimally apply the change or when it should be applied. It also dictates the specific details, like how much gas is, should the amount of gas be the same as it would take to for other transactions, or should it be more expensive, should it be less expensive, should we support it's up to the policy. And who should pay it? Should it be paid by the origin, or should it be paid by the contract in which there is a bug? So yeah, so this is what the policy would dictate. Okay, and finally, now the miners actually show support by adding vote transactions. This is another kind of transaction that we add in the mined blocks. So after this green block, we get three continuous blocks in which first one shows support by saying yes, we support. Second one says no, we don't, and the third one says yes. And we wait for L blocks, and if there is sufficient votes according to the policy, we apply the repair. So in this case, we say if more than 50% in L blocks after the repair has been mined, we say the rule is as follows: after the repair is mined, we wait for L blocks. In this case, L is 6. If more than 50% of the blocks mined after this repair block support for the repair, we apply the repair. So this is an example repair policy. And we see that in this case, that is true. We have overwhelming support for the repair. And now we actually, this repair is approved. Okay, so to apply the repairs, what we do is we maintain two additional data structures called the repair database and an approval database. And for all normal blocks, we use the underlying blockchain's validate block function. So we use the, as I said, when you inherit the existing blockchain, we use that existing blockchain's validate block function. At the point of approval, you add some additional information to these databases so that you know that this is not a normal block. This something special is happening here. And when syncing, give the new nodes the full blockchain and the additional two databases so that they can also realize, okay, this is what's happening here. This is a special block. I need to actually change something. Okay, so let's take a look at how to actually apply the repair in Ethereum. So as I said, there are two kinds of pointers. The orange pointer is the state pointer or the generic pointer, and then you have the hash pointers. So when you have a buggy contract, you just store the state in a database and you actually apply the repair here. You change the block. Now you know that all the hash links will break, and both generic links will also break because you've just changed some of the transactions here. And we preserve the hash pointers in all of these. We don't update the block and update the parent hash pointer. So we leave this as is, and we actually update the state pointers here, and only in the new block does the updated state show up. So until then, you preserve the old pointers. And during mining, when you are validating the chain, all you are going to do is to replace this not buggy with buggy, and then all the links are magically fine. And during at the red point, you know it's a special block because you have seen the repair block and you have applied the policy on your own, and you know this is a special block. So you know that you are expected for this link to break from the previous block. So that's fine. Okay. Yeah, as I said, the key idea is during syncing, you actually regenerate the originally mined chain, thereby preserving safety and preserving the consensus rules. And finally, it also does not affect light clients, because all the light clients do is actually give me the latest header, and on the header there will be a state route, and they'll just ask me, give me all the states according to this state route. So for them, they don't need to worry about reapplying all the repairs. So all they need to ask is to get the latest state route. Okay, so now how to enable repair reparo in other blockchains. So as a summary, any blockchain protocol that wants to enable reparo just needs to do the following: create a policy P, add the two new transactions, repair transaction and vote transaction, and build these databases, change validate chain and validate block to use these new databases, so that when you are validating block, you are aware that, okay, this could potentially have broken pointers, and how do I deal with the broken pointers? Okay, so we implemented it on Ethereum, and we observed that we took a transfer transaction as the baseline. So this is a transaction where I I send to another account some money, and it costs 21,000 gas as a minimum. So this is the minimum gas costing transaction that you can ever have as of now. And we see that our repair transaction and vote transactions are not anything far off from this baseline transaction. So it's efficient in that way. We also added this and just checked how much time it would take to import an existing blockchain, right? So we added additional checks to validate block and validate chain. So we wanted to see the impact on an unregulated, unrepaired chain. We observed a very small increase to update some very dense blocks as of then. So the details are in the paper. And practically, what would you expect by implementing Reparo on Ethereum? You would see that by paying very small gas fees, you can actually fix bugs. Okay, there is a small caveat here. To fix deeper bugs, there is a second policy that you could use called state assertion, where you just say that just like the one that was done by the Ethereum in the code, if DAO is equal to do this, we can assert that via a repair itself. So in the repair request, you say change the DAO contract state to this one. And I'm doing this because of such a bug, and this is why I'm doing it. And with that, you can actually spend very little amount and go arbitrarily deep without affecting anything. So and these are the numbers to apply repairs using such a policy. And you can see that using less than one ether, you can actually fix things that had a lot more impact. Okay, so to conclude, Reparo is a publicly verifiable repair layer for any blockchain. By implementing Reparo, you can make any blockchain get the ability to repair any content who are publicly verifiable, and you can improve the chain quality by actually removing the malicious content. You can remove the attack transactions. And you can be compliant to any regulations. So there will not be any resistance to blockchains. Right? Thanks.